So good afternoon, everyone. We're going to reconvene for the final session of today. We've had a, I think, very real world and very insightful set of discussions about the U.S. interest in international financial cooperation, not just from the public, but also from the private sector, not just from Americans, but also from friends from abroad. But for our final session today, we're going to turn to a distinguished U.S. public servant, though Ted gets annoyed when I say this, the Honorable Nathan Sheets. Okay, I could say it to you too. The Honorable Ted gets annoyed when I say this, the Honorable Nathan Sheets. Don't worry, Ted, I only do it the first time he comes out, which is the point. We are delighted that Nathan is now a visiting fellow here at the Peterson Institute, and this is his debut on our stage as a fellow. To just repeat what I said earlier, for those of you tuning in online or who came for lunch, Nathan is in many ways the ideal of the economic technocrat. He, after getting his PhD at MIT, he went to work at the Federal Reserve Board, spent a long and distinguished career there, producing not only good research, but becoming increasingly involved in leadership, and ultimately ending up as director of the Division of International Finance. He then, prior to and during part of the crisis, was head of global economics at Citigroup, or Citi, or whatever it's now called, which of course gave him a different perspective and set of insights. And I know from our many friends in the private sector, he was highly esteemed for his briefings and his insights that were market-oriented. He recently completed service as the Undersecretary for International Affairs at the United States Treasury, during the second Obama term. Most importantly for today's discussion, that means both in his prior role at the Federal Reserve and his last role at the Treasury, he was the point person for dealing with the FSB, for dealing with bilateral US-EU financial issues, for dealing with China. These are important insights. And so Nathan will address today, I don't think it will be a surprise in terms of bottom line, but I think the content is enormously important. Even when you've been burnt in international negotiations, and even when Congress burns you for attending them, why you still show up in the morning and do that. Nathan, please.
Well, it's very much a pleasure to be here today to share some thoughts on issues related to U.S. international economic leadership and particularly what that means for the Financial Stability Board. I should quickly observe that the discussion that has preceded me today has been extremely, extremely rich. And it is tempting to want to pivot toward a summing up kind of thing because there has been so much of great value that's been articulated. Nevertheless, the underlying narrative that I prepared is one that I feel deeply and passionately about, and it's one that that I would like to articulate. So I'll move forward with the original remarks, but I will, along the way, make some comments about some of the things that we've heard in the discussion. So let's start this review at the foundations, at the rudiments. What are the key elements of U.S. economic leadership? And based on my observations and my experience, I would say that there are several that are particularly important. First, we're the largest national economy. Second, our financial markets are preeminent. Third, we have a legacy of past leadership. I would say here lags matter. And as a result of decades of leadership, and significant contributions to the international system, our shareholding, our quotas, and so forth in the international financial institutions are significant. And as a related matter, our currency is the reserve currency, and our government securities are the global safe asset. But the nature of our leadership goes beyond the size of our economy and markets and the past. It also reflects the quality of our ideas and the fact that the United States in international fora engages as vigorously, arguably more vigorously, than the other jurisdictions. And when we come to G20 meetings or G7 meetings or other international events, we are, again, at least as prepared, and I would say arguably more prepared than others around the table. So part of it is what our economy is, but another important part of that leadership is the way that we engage in the international process. And then finally, I would say another aspect of this that has given us credibility in recent years is that U.S. policymakers, in some sense, passed the test during the last crisis. And here I would highlight in particular that the dollar was the safe haven currency through that period, and that the Fed acted as a global lender of last resort. That was the case directly through the swap line programs, which is an initiative that's near and dear to my heart, but also indirectly through the discount window and some of the other facilities where there was significant international participation. So then the next question is, okay, we have this international leadership. What are the domestic benefits? Well, when we lead, we do lead with an eye on the global commons. We seek outcomes that are hopefully fair and transparent, rules-based. As many have said, this race to the top framework. But importantly, when we're in these negotiations, we also are very much aware of our affiliation and of our national origin, and what are policies that are in the best interests of the United States and the U.S. people. And consistent with that observation, we seek to give resources in directions that will be helpful for the United States. And then similarly, we, as others have noted, encourage other jurisdictions to implement the same kind of high-quality policies and programs that we have adopted here at home. Now, there is an important flip side on this that I think is very important, and that is if we don't lead, other countries will. And they may have an eye on the global commons, but they are going to lead in ways that are consistent with their own national interests. And let me just give you one example of this. And this is a extraordinary headline that came across the wires about 10 days ago. Its title is China Defends WTO in Face of Trump Rebuke. And the first line of it is, the world's second largest economy is seeking to position itself as a defender of the international trade system. I think this is also consistent with President Xi's very high visibility speech that he gave in mid-January in Davos. And I think it's also, in some sense, consistent with the analysis that Nicola put forward, that that if the United States doesn't lead, other countries will, and they may take the global system in directions that are inconsistent with or incompatible with U.S. interests. So, agenda for the talk. First, I'll now pivot and focus on one specific example of international coordination and cooperation, the Financial Stability Board, and then look at the ongoing domestic debate. And we've heard some of it today. There's also been a parallel political criticism of the FSB that I'll look at some of those issues as well. Talk a little bit about what the FSB's actually accomplished, and then finally talk about a few reforms that I think could further enhance the FSB's effectiveness. Now, coming out of the financial crisis, I would say there were two key objectives that policymakers had. The first one was to establish stronger, better financial regulation. The second one, it's really the focus here, is to ensure as much international consistency as possible. And it's very natural to ask the question, well, why? Why was that an objective? And I should underscore that it was clearly an objective of both the Bush administration through the end of 2008 and was taken mid-stride by the Obama administration in early 2009. There was bipartisan agreement. My list would be the following three things. First, to avoid regulatory arbitrage. If some jurisdictions have weaker regulation than others, what you're going to see is risks building up in those jurisdictions. When those jurisdictions face problems, those challenges, given the nature of global interlinkages, are going to be felt elsewhere, including in the United States. And arguably, we saw some of that in the global financial crisis. The second reason why it was important to achieve consistency was to avoid fragmented global markets, to allow the flow of credit to move to efficient uses across the globe. And then the third one is to provide a level playing field for US institutions to compete abroad. But the bottom line here is that favorable outcomes for the United States require responsible policies in other countries. Problems abroad will flow onto our shores if we don't work with those authorities to achieve strong regulation. And for what it was worth, there was broad international agreement on both of these. Now, on this slide, I'm going to go fairly quickly, but let me just make the following point. In thinking about how do we achieve international cooperation, broadly speaking, there are two models. One is we adopt those regulations nationally and then seek to internationalize them. Okay? Now, that obviously has advantages in that we're able to put national interests first. The problem is it's also very likely to result in patchwork, fragmented regulation. The United States is large and we're the leader, but we can't dictate to the rest of the world. The other model is sort of the Woodrow Wilson League of Nations model, is where you agree to it internationally and then try to impose it on the United States. And obviously that's not politically feasible either. So in reality, in thinking about how does regulation arise in the United States versus in the rest of the world, it requires a process of triangulation, of being aware of the absolute priority of national interests, but also thinking carefully about what's feasible for the rest of the world. And I would argue why the FSB, key point, is the FSB facilitates this cooperation and makes this sort of triangulation of interest possible. Now, the structure of the FSB. We've talked a fair amount about that this morning already. It was established by the G20 leaders. It includes all the major jurisdictions. The Treasury, the Fed, and the SEC are members. It also includes the major standard-setting bodies like the Basel Committee and IOSCO, which is the securities regulators, and its chair, it's an important point, it's chaired by Mark Carney, who's the governor of the Bank of England. And what's important here is Carney has been the chair for the last 6 years, and his term as chair will expire in November. So this means that 2017 is going to be a period of leadership transition for the FSB. Some other senior leaders of the FSB, including Dan Trullo, are also moving on. And I'll come back to this point about leadership turnover. Now, heart and soul here, this is really what I want to focus on. What are the domestic criticisms of the FSB? Well, poorly governed and unaccountable to political oversight, compromises U.S. sovereignty and forces bad policies that the U.S. doesn't want on our system and on our regulators. It's secretive and non-transparent. The policies don't reflect U.S. interests. And all of this is actually embodied, or a lot of it at least, is embodied in this quote from Representative McHenry to Janet Yellen. And in particular, the line that these standards are being negotiated with bureaucrats in foreign lands without transparency, accountability, or the authority to do so. In addition, there's another line of argumentation that we heard to some extent from Barbara, which is a concern that the FSB and its policies may be too bank-centric and just too much stuff happening, which in some sense also harkens back to the concern about transparency. So let me talk about these one by one. So in terms of governance and functioning, the FSB reports regularly to G20 ministers and governors several times a year and annually to the leaders. It's clear who's running the show. It's the ministers and governors and the leaders. It's not the FSB. Decisions in the FSB are taken by consensus. So if a jurisdiction simply cannot live with an outcome, they have the capacity to block it. And other approaches and arrangements have to be found. And indeed, late last year, there was an example where a jurisdiction blocked an agreement, and compromises were found. So these decisions that are coming out of the FSB, here's the next step, they are by consensus, but even so, they're not formally or legally binding on FSB members. And in fact, the FSB charter says that the group doesn't create any legal rights or obligations for its members, and there's an expectation that these agreements that are made at the FSB will be translated into domestic regulations in the various jurisdictions with due regard for the unique circumstances that are there. Instead of formal requirements, the FSB uses moral suasion and peer review to motivate its members. But clearly the members, this is the flip side of that, the members do have incentives to implement. There are advantages to a level playing field. The peer reviews are a measure of accountability. And ultimately your credibility in the international regulatory process will depend on whether or not you implement today, that this is very much seen and in fact is a repeated game. Now, one specific example here that let me just highlight, and this is the FSB has taken steps to identify systemically important institutions, and the membership has agreed to have higher standards and requirements for them. And I would argue that this is broadly similar to the regime that Congress mandated under Dodd-Frank. So Congress mandated a regime similar to this under Dodd-Frank, and then we have seen over time this be adopted globally as an approach by the FSB. As a result of this, I would argue that capital levels for these large institutions abroad are higher, and the system is safer. And let me just highlight here Chair Yellen's response to Representative McHenry, which very much touches on this. By participating in the development of international regulatory standards, the Federal Reserve can influence the standards in ways that promote the financial stability of the United States. In some important instances, U.S. agencies have used international forums to promote standards already determined domestically, I would argue, like the G-SIBs, to be important for U.S. financial stability. The issue of transparency The FSB charter requires it to consult and to have structured processes for those consultations. The FSB has a website. I've spent a lot of time on the FSB's website in recent weeks. There's a huge amount of information, press releases, annual reports, a relatively new annual report assessing implementation and effects of reforms, speeches, detailed documents requesting public comment. So there's a lot up there. Is this enough? I think that the clear trend in the way the FSB is operating is toward greater transparency. Nevertheless, this is an issue, I would say, in both the academic debate and in the political debate that's highlighted. Is the FSB transparent enough? And I think this year, with these leadership changes, particularly Chair Carney moving on as FSB chair, that this would be a natural time to think harder and for the group itself to do a review on that. Now, let me pivot in the remaining time that I have and address a somewhat different set of questions, and that is, what has the FSB actually accomplished? So I've talked some about governance and transparency and how it functions. I very much argue that the FSB is responds to the members and helps shape the debate, but doesn't create legal requirements. But really, the ultimate question that we must care about is the question, is the global system safer than it was before? And is the global system safer than it would have been if we hadn't have had the FSB? And I would argue, yes. Doesn't mean that everything's been done or everything's actually even been done perfectly along the way. But on balance, the system is safer. Banks have more capital and better quality of capital, and there's additional liquidity buffers in place. And let me just show a little bit of data. And I should add parenthetically that these kinds of data are not that easy to come by. And it would be constructive for the FSB and other international institutions to think about better sources of data that are consistent on these kinds of things across countries. But I'll go relatively quickly through this. The chart on the right-hand side shows tier one capital for some advanced economies in 2007 and in 2015. All of the dots are above the line, suggesting that capital levels have increased significantly relative to before the crisis. Another measure, these charts focus on the G-SIBs, the global systemically important banks. The red line is the capital ratios, tier one capital ratios for the G-SIBs, which have roughly doubled since 2011, and the quantum of capital, the blue line, has increased quite significantly as well. The right panel looks at the distribution of the capital increase between the U.S. institutions and the foreign institutions. And I just put this chart in to highlight that both U.S. and foreign institutions have significantly increased their capital levels. So what we're doing at home is being echoed by regulators abroad. Here's a measure of liquidity. Liquidity shortfalls relative to liquidity coverage ratio, or LCR. The red bars have fallen, and measures of the liquidity coverage ratio have moved up from about 1.15 to about 1.25. So measures of liquidity in the banking system are higher. And then finally, and this is just one measure, the FSB has also worked hard to make derivatives markets safer. The opaqueness and interlinkages of these markets was a problem during the financial crisis. Now there's more clearing, standardized trading and reporting. Here I show you that significant increase in central clearing of OTC derivatives trades, which was one of the objectives, and I would argue makes the system safer than it was 10 years ago. Here, a few other accomplishments of the FSB that are harder to quantify. Some improvement has been made in resolution frameworks, progress toward ending too big to fail. The development of the total loss absorbing capacity standard is important. Shadow banking, Barbara talked a fair amount about that. The FSB has actually evolved. I use the old term here. Most of the FSB documents now call it market-based finance. But you know, essentially it boils down to intermediation that occurs outside the explicitly regulated financial institution. And ironically, the term shadow banking, as I understand it at least, was first articulated or coined by Macaulay, who was at the time working at PIMCO, part of the shadow banking system, and I don't think he intended it, and typically has not been used in policy discussions as being disparaging. But in the shadow banking market based finance realm, continued review of potential systemic risks associated with non-banks, particularly asset managers. Now, in mid-January, the FSB came out with a detailed list of 14 recommendations to look at the various activities of asset managers. My sense is that is a credible effort that has involved the asset managers. I think Barbara, in her remarks, very much agreed with that. But you know, the point, and maybe we can talk more about this, that the process on asset managers has been challenging. I mean, that's absolutely right. But I think it is for the reason that Patrick highlighted, is that we saw at least a possibility that there were some risks in the system. And it was in an area where we didn't have experience with regulation. So in any event, I would argue that the efforts made by the FSB have made the system safer. Doesn't mean that we're done or everything's been done exactly right, but on balance, safer. What is the FSB going to do going forward? Well, I really like this quote from Mark Carney, and particularly the first part. Our collective priorities must be to implement our past agreements in a full, timely, and constant manner. Really, the key now is to implement the work and the agreements that are already in existence. I think there's broad agreement in the international community that we don't need further significant enhancements in what we have. At least there's not evidence for that yet, which actually gets me down to that very last bullet. So the two most important things on there in my mind are implementation and the last bullet, strengthening tools to evaluate the effects of existing reforms. The FSB has commenced an annual report looking at the effects of reforms and continues to develop tools, and we'll see this over the summer when this report comes out, to better evaluate whether the reforms are having the intended consequences. And as we get a better infrastructure and framework in place to evaluate where we are, and I think that that's very much in the pipeline, then I think it's natural for us to come back to the question, is there more that we need to do? Are there gaps that we need to fill? Are there places where maybe it's been too much or not sufficiently effective? The other elements on the list, I think, have been discussed by other speakers this morning. But that first bullet and the last bullet are really what I see as being the key for the next few years. So then finally, how can the FSB increase its effectiveness further? As you deduce, I think the FSB has a strong record. Nevertheless, stepping back and thinking and evaluating is still very constructive. It's appropriate for the G20 to do this as the governance group for the FSB, and it's also appropriate for the FSB itself to focus on this. some issues, some questions that I would ask on representation. Do you have the right mix of members? And you could think about that across geographies. There are a lot of Europeans. On the other hand, the U.S. representatives around the table vigorously engage, and the views of those representatives are recognized, consistent with the weight of the U.S. economy. But is it right across geographies? Is it right across areas of expertise? Should there be more representatives from securities regulators or markets regulators? In the United States, the SEC plays a critical role in our participation in the FSB. The CFTC is brought in as well, and this is true for other jurisdictions. But thinking about representation, along the way, I highlighted the issue of transparency. Are there further refinements that would be helpful to the FSB in achieving its mandate? Public communication, can the FSB make its case more persuasively? I think this is a subset of this might be thinking about releasing additional data that would help various observers have a discussion about how global capital standards and liquidity standards have evolved. And then finally, the issue of focus. Are all work streams fully focused on the issue of financial stability? There are a lot of other interesting things that the FSB could do that don't necessarily link in directly to financial stability. So let me conclude. If I had to list three key benefits, it would be a safer, more effective global system, more level global playing field around high standards, and then sort of the flip side, that if we don't engage, that vacuum isn't going to be there forever. Others will step in. Thank you.
Nathan, when you mentioned turnover and leadership at the FSB, you didn't mention the fact that you're no longer there either. So there is a lot of change going on. We're a little over our normal time. The sun's coming out, so I'm sure everyone wants to get their sleds. So let me just put one question to you, or two questions to you quickly, and then we'll open it up. First is, I mean, you talked about the FSB and the many facets that could go on, but obviously there are other things going on besides the FSB. So our colleague Nicholas Varone mentioned, as he's wont to do, accounting. Can you take us through what, just in that area, is another example of U.S. role in international, and what are the limits of international cooperation?
Yeah, thank you for that question. Achieving an international convergence in accounting standards has been an objective of the G20 and the FSB for the last decade. And in fact, if you go back to the original G20 communiques, or the first leaders' meetings, what were some of the key things that the FSB was asked to do? It was to move the ball forward on accounting and convergence of accounting standards. In the intervening 6 to 10 years, the international system, international bodies have worked vigorously in pursuit of that objective, and I think that we've come to a conclusion that there are some differences that are just of a almost a theological nature that are not going to be bridged, and that there are some places where, regardless of how hard we try to achieve international convergence, we're not going to get all the way to where we want to go. The analogy I've used on this for quite some time is that, yeah, this is like religion. Yeah, you know, trying to turn the gap people into I first people and vice versa is like trying to get Protestants to become Catholics and vice versa. It's just not going to happen. So my sense is that that is an issue, at least for now. I mean, maybe in a different generation, but at least for now, it's been put to the side. But that doesn't mean it's not an important issue. I think that it's clearly an important issue in terms of transparency of the system. And then it also comes in interpreting leverage ratios and differences in European leverage ratios versus U.S. leverage ratios. So it's important, but I think that's one where we've tried and it just hasn't happened.
Thank you. One more question, if I could. You were, as you always have been, both forceful and circumspect. Now that you're out of office, I'm going to push you to be a little bit more less circumspect. Sort of in the spirit of Jason's question earlier to our previous panel, you know, if Congress has a bug in its bonnet, a bee in its bonnet, that international cooperation prima facie must be contrary to U.S. interests, you know, how should we go about responding to that? Should we just say to them, like I was saying earlier, you know, there's going to be fewer American investment bankers abroad and you're going to lose tax money? Should it be reasoning with them? Should, you know, what? Where do we go from here if Congress has that attitude?
So I think the biggest risk, if we pull back, stems from then having different regimes in different countries, and those folks that are running institutions and investing are going to put the money where they expect to have the highest return. And the result of that is going to be regulatory arbitrage, building up of risks in some of these key jurisdictions that are more lightly regulated. And I am absolutely confident that if we hadn't had the FSB, there are some jurisdictions that would have softer regulation than they have today. I'm not going to say everywhere in the world. I mean, the Swiss are clearly committed to it. But there are some jurisdictions that would be less regulated. And I think there would be vulnerabilities associated with the lower level of regulation that they have. But even more so, the differential that they would get more risk building up in their system. As we saw in the financial crisis, what happens in the States has implications for the rest of the world, but significantly, what's happening in the rest of the world is going to impact the U.S. So this means more financial stresses, more potential crises in the United States, and those crises, I mean, are terrible, terrible events in terms of their costs on real families and real human lives, in terms of employment, credit availability, business creation. I mean, one of the extraordinary signatures of the financial crisis is household formation. It fell sharply during the crisis and is still much below where it was beforehand. So it's as fundamental as people getting married and people leaving home and starting their lives independently, that the crisis risks are significant. And then I think that a more fragmented system is going to be one that's less capable of being able to support credit. And that means, you know, less opportunities for people to buy houses and get cars and start businesses and so forth. I think that there really are significant, meaningful, bottom line implications. And let me also add, I very much agree with the spirit of the question and the orientation of today's discussion, that I think on a lot of these issues, those of us that are strongly in favor of global engagement and international cooperation and international integration, we simply have to articulate our case in a way that is more forceful and more compelling to the businessman on Main Street, the family in the heartland of the country. We've fallen short.
Thank you for that very much. So we're going to have one final round of questions. As usual, Jessica is here with a traveling mic in front. There's a microphone in back. I mean, obviously, not Jason.
I'm flattered by the comparison.
No. Nathan's closing would have been a fabulous closing to the day, but I don't want to cut off the questions. Anyone, please?
German. German Zettelmeyer, PIIE. So Nathan, even though it would have been a fabulous closing, I still want to challenge you a little bit on it, because you know the basic point you made is the strongest argument for international financial cooperation is to prevent the dangers of regulatory arbitrage. But I suspect that the guys who want to suspend international financial cooperation in the US Congress, if there are such people, want to do it precisely because they want the US to take the lead in international regulatory arbitrage operation. They want to lower financial standards here, and they do not want to be fettered by anyone in Basel or anywhere else in preventing them from doing it. So how are you going to respond to those people, if at all?
Oh, that's a great question. Now, arguably, the scenario you articulate is a special case of what I was saying. I was saying that you'd have regulatory arbitrage that would build up in the weakly regulated jurisdictions. If the U.S. happens to be the weakly regulated jurisdiction where the risks are building up, and we also saw some of that before the financial crisis. As an aside here, I thought Patrick's point that before the financial crisis, the U.S. led a effort to deregulate is right. So if we're moving in that direction, we're the lightly regulated jurisdiction, and that means we're going to be the epicenter of the financial crisis, which is a even more detrimental and potentially damaging scenario for us. Now, stepping back from it, I'm kind of in the group of people that am not yet convinced as to where this new administration is going to go. On at least on explicit regulatory policy. I do believe that sort of the way the existing regs are implemented is likely to be in a more gentle, less vigorous, less thorough way, with CCAR probably being the most marked softening. But I would be surprised to see a stepping back from the capital liquidity standards that are articulated as a result of Dodd-Frank. And in particular, I mean, for, say, Congress to repeal them, I mean, the headline would be, Trump administration goes soft on big banks. And that's a politically, I think, challenging headline for an administration of any party.
Great. Please.
Lou Pauley, University of Toronto. That was really a fascinating talk. I wonder if you could just connect your conclusion to the beginning and just speculate a little bit about the politics of this. When we're appealing to the heartland about the virtues of international cooperation, what if the heartland is saying in the most recent election that the fact that the U.S. was the international lender of last resort with their money, and that some of the implications of that action were seen as personally costly, how do we convince them?
Yeah, I mean, no one wants to jump up and down and say the policies that were pursued during the financial crisis were policies that we were excited about at the time, or are excited about in retrospect. The reason those policies, those crisis management policies, were put in place is that regardless of how hard they were to do and how unpalatable they might have seemed, not doing them would have been even worse. It would have been far, far worse. Which then gets us to a central tension. I remember at one of the hearings of the House Financial Services Committee that I went to with Chairman Bernanke, and it was when Barney Frank was still chairman of that committee. And Barney Frank mentioned in passing, nobody ever gets reelected with a bumper sticker that says, without me, things would have even been worse than they are. that doesn't appeal to hearts and minds. So, you know, people saw things they didn't like. Well, I think I've just articulated my views. I really believe in international cooperation, and I believe in the crisis management efforts that were put into place. But I saw things I didn't like as well. So I think that somehow we need to think about how do we reframe this discussion. What are the advantages of international cooperation? Well, we know, and we need to think about how to make this more transparent and obvious. We know that international trade creates jobs. And we know that the trade that's created by international, you know, by increased exports, that those tend to be good jobs, high-paying jobs. The problem is that the flip side of that is there's also trade, employment destruction. And it's easier to point at a factory that says, oh, that factory is out of business because of international trade, than it is to point to a job or a factory that's there because of increased exports. Those tend to be more incremental and spread evenly, you know, throughout the system in many different plants. And it's also harder to walk into the store and say, well, if it weren't for international trade, all of this stuff would be fill in the blank, 10, 15, whatever percent higher than it is. But I do think there's a narrative there. I think there maybe is also an interesting narrative that I've seen some of the analytics done in the past of how foreign institutions working in the United States and operating in the United States support credit and lending and job creation and so on and so forth. I think that's an interesting discussion. But what are these positive narratives where we can point to good stuff that people have in their lives that flows as a result of international cooperation? In addition to this, oh, we're protecting it from the bad stuff, but it's harder to win the elections and win the debates on, oh, without us, it would even have been worse.
Well, without Nathan, the last few years would have been more than a bit worse for the rest of the world and for the U.S. So thank you for joining us. Thank you all for coming in today. This meeting is adjourned.